Welcome to the broadcast. Tonight, a conversation with David Letterman.
We have an audience of about 500 people. They come from wherever they come from. They write in for tickets 6 months, 3 months, a year in advance. They get plane tickets, they get babysitters, they get rental cars, they go to hotels, they have to park their car, they have to walk, they have to wait in line. So we get these people in there. And at the end of the evening, I get the sense that these people are disappointed. I realize I've failed.
An hour with David Letterman when we continue.
Charlie Rose is made possible by a grant from USA Networks as part of our continuing commitment to innovative television. Through USA Network and the Sci-Fi Channel, we provide original entertainment to America and the world. Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
David Letterman is here. He is a broadcaster's broadcaster, and I am very pleased to have him for this hour. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Charlie. Pleasure to be here.
Tell me about, what you seem to have to know a little bit about you is this love, this love of broadcasting.
Yeah.
Where is that from?
I guess when I was a kid, because when I was a kid, broadcasting, television at least, I guess strictly speaking, broadcasting is radio. But television was a kid also, and, you know, it was a big day in our house when the delivery boys, about an eight-man crew, unloaded something, you know, roughly the size of this room, and it turned out to be, I think, an Admiral TV.
Black and white.
Yeah. And we plugged it in and turned it on, and, of course, in those days, you turn it on, and then you wait two or three days, and then the picture comes up. It was just this. You could see, at night when you went to bed, you could sense the glow developing. And then, you know, you get the TV on Monday. By Thursday, it was ready to watch. And I can remember, and I don't know why I was home from school, because I, you know, should have been in school, but I can remember seeing these shows coming out of New York. Arthur Godfrey, and then I think for a long time he was simulcasting his radio show. Was his television show, and there was something very fascinating about that, because Arthur Godfrey used to sit there with these giant old headphones and had a giant DX77 or 44 RCA microphone, and it was something just captivating about having a strange man in your house, although, you know, with Mom, we had plenty of strange men in our house.
Well, that's not true.
Let's strike that from the record.
Yeah,
but, you know, there was this guy, and here I was, I don't know, 7 or 8 years old, and for some reason, you know, Arthur Godfrey was talking to me, and for the life of me, I don't know what Arthur Godfrey and I then, or even now, or ever would have had in common, but there was that, it was a guy talking to you. And then after that show, I think we went to do a show, it was like the Gary Moore Show.
Yeah.
And it was just a different version of Arthur Godfrey. Gary Moore was really great. I'm not certain how he was regarded in his day, but my feeling is he was underrated, because I think he had a very, very long, successful career in broadcasting. I think from what people tell me, our old director, Hal Gurney, actually worked with Gary Moore. Said he was a decent guy, a nice, nice, decent guy, and he was also very good. But it was just that sense of somebody's talking to me, and there's something fascinating and captivating about it. And that's that for me was, I don't know, I can't over-romanticize this and say that, boom, that was the moment. But it, you know, it had an impact on me, and I think everybody else who was new to television and vice versa.
How about people like Kovacs?
Didn't know much about him, actually. Saw him a little bit here and there, but honestly didn't know much about his... I know he had several shows, and I know he was regarded as being very inventive, and there was a time, I guess when we were doing a morning show at NBC, that people made some comparisons between what we were doing and what he was doing, and I can only say that I was flattered by that, but it was purely accidental.
And there was even a story that you and your staff went over to the Museum of Broadcasting and watched all the old Kovacs shows just to get a feeling for what it was that he was about.
No, we went over there because I think they had a free buffet one day.
Yes, and why not?
Yeah. We actually went over there and looked at some old Steve Allen shows. Because when I was a little bit older, as like 12 or 13, on Friday night, my family would let me stay up. Well, let me, you know, what the hell did they care? So I would stay up and I would watch this Steve Allen show that I remembered later in my life as being just wild and uncontrollable and unpredictable and silly and goofy. So those are the shows that we actually went over to dig up out of the museum. And we looked at those, and I think also along the way, because our announcer in those days, Bill Wendell, had been the announcer on the Ernie Kovacs show, so we looked at some of those as well. But the ones we were really looking for were the Steve Allen Westinghouse shows.
How about Parr?
Well, Parr was an influence in my life early on. And I can remember occasionally getting to stay up and watch him. And for me, you know, Jack Parr was like the, for a kid in Indianapolis, that was like the New Yorker magazine. Everything
was
very sophisticated, very witty, crackling.
Everybody stopped by to say
that's
hello.
That's right, dropping in.
Alexander King was part of his.
And the air was electric with a fascinating conversation. And then later, again, through Hal, our director, I was, you know, lucky enough to meet Jack Parr. And it was amazing. When I met Jack, I think he was in his 70s, and was invited to his house a couple of times, and it was like Jack was still doing the show. I mean, I don't mean to suggest that he was nuts and had the set, everything in the living room, and Miriam, his wife, was introduced.
Here.
No, it wasn't like that, but he was bright and alive and full of curiosity, and it was like he had not missed a beat from the time he really was the king of late night. Mm-hmm. This guy, you know, that's back then, that's when he was getting like a 50-60 share night in and night out. And the country hung on this man's every word.
He left it all. Can you imagine walking away from it?
Well, it's nice to think that you could. He left it all. He walked away. He did it for 5 years, which seems that's not even spit in a bucket now. And then he did some primetime things, and then he walked away completely. But he came back.
Yeah,
and he came back later,
well.
And it did not work as well. And it's a lesson that one should learn, because nobody did it as well as he did. And then to have his return to television, it was ignominy. You know, it shouldn't have. He was badly handled, badly treated, and I think he recognized that it was a mistake. But imagining walking away from it, I would love to say, oh yeah, I'm the kind of guy, I'm full of native curiosity and joie de vivre.
I want to go to Africa.
Yeah, exactly.
I want to make a tour of the world.
But I don't know.
I've got books I want to write, paintings I want to paint.
Yeah, that's, I don't know. It would be a challenge. But maybe a challenge worth the meeting, yeah. You know, I don't know.
I don't know, because I think of what you do, which is different than what I do, but we're all broadcasters. I can't imagine wanting to do anything that would be as much of a turn-on as this.
No, it's when it works, it's great fun. And this is the only thing. I was talking to somebody earlier, and they say, "Yeah, you want to be in a situation comedy? You want to be in a movie?" And good Lord, no. I mean, when this thing explodes, and I hope when it does, it doesn't hurt too many people. I'm done. I would like to stay in television in some way, but I don't want to. Then, you know, it's Dave. He's the goofy dentist. He's too much laughing gas. Look out! Thursdays at 9 on CBS. That ain't going to happen. You know.
It makes Carson all that more remarkable that he could do it that long,
you know,
good.
I tell you, it makes me sick. Occasionally, I was flying somewhere, and they had some kind of thing with, they were showing clips from the old Tonight Show, and it just makes you sick. It makes you sick because I know what it takes for me to get through a 60-minute effort each night. And then you look at Carson, and it's so easy. It's so smooth. It's so measured. He's not breaking a sweat. He's not running around screaming. They don't have fireworks. They don't have monkeys jumping up and down on lithium. It's just Johnny. And he's so comfortable. And so here was a guy that understood his limitations and stayed within them and exploited that part of his personality to perfection. And I think that was the appeal of the man. Night in and night out, it was always going to be Johnny. Johnny, you could tell if Johnny would raise an eyebrow, oh, Johnny's upset. Johnny laugh, oh, Johnny's happy. But it was never much more than that, and he was very, very good at that.
What was the genius, though? I mean, what made him, he could do that night in, night out?
I think it was that part of his personality, where he was, he never overplayed. He never tried to get out of what he was good at. And he was so comfortable. You never get tired of watching it. And, you know, you could watch him on Tuesday, he'd be the same on Friday. It was just like, oh, here's Johnny. Literally, here's Johnny. And he was something very comforting about that. And I think a cultural phenomenon. I can't imagine another single personality attaining that status now.
Is that why you so badly wanted to assume that mantle?
It was a pretty good job. It was a pretty good job. And when I was a kid, I remember watching The Tonight Show and thinking to myself, well, hell, I could do that. Yeah. Now, it's interesting that I would have that impression, because I think that that's a testament to how easily he made it look, where a goofball kid like me would think, well, hell, I can do that. And it's, for me, it's not as easy as it was for Johnny. But, you know, I did want it. I mean, it was a great job. And at the time, there were not many other jobs open. There were no other jobs open. So when I left my 12:30 show, there was nowhere else to go. So if I wanted to stay in broadcasting, which I did, doing the kind of thing I wanted, It had to be the Tonight Show.
Let me just go back to leaving Indianapolis, though, and going to L.A. Were you set on being a talk show host, or were you just going out there to get into television and to do comedy?
Well, it was when I left Indianapolis, I had worked at a television station. I actually started working in TV like in 1969 when I was 19 or 20. And I had worked at the station for 5 years, worked at a radio station, and just I knew something else was going on. I had the sense that there's something else out there. And I didn't think I was going to be satisfied or fulfilled doing a 4-H half-hour kid show once a week. And I would see these guys come on The Tonight Show, these comedians, and I would think, oh, man, I just wonder maybe if I could do that a little bit. So I told my family I was going out to be a writer, you know, because the idea of me actually being in show business, that would have horrified and sickened everyone. And now, come to think of it, the fact of me in show business actually horrifies and sickens millions.
Yeah, but then you brought your mother into show business.
Oh, Lord. So I just said, no, I'm going to go out to be a writer because I really felt like that's my calling. I said, I'm a goofy-looking guy. Nobody really going to want me on the screen. But I knew in the back of my mind what I would try is to get into comedy, to do stand-up comedy. And in those days, you knew how to do that, and that was go right to the comedy store and start doing it. Before that, I wouldn't have known how to get into comedy.
Did it come natural for you?
More or less, yeah. No. Like anything else, there are some... You have an affinity for something, but there are still many, many things to learn. You know, I can remember the first night I was on stage at the Comedy Store, and my first reaction was this bright white light, and I thought it was one of those near-death tales. I thought, oh, there's the white light. I guess I'm coming home, Uncle Eddie. And I can just remember, you can kind of just, there's something visceral. You can sort of smell the people out there because they're all just loaded up on watered-down drinks. And all of a sudden, it was an out-of-body experience because I just could see myself standing there saying words that I had memorized to the silence, but still smelling the people. And it was an exhilarating experience, but also a complete failure.
And then when you got the laughs?
Well, that night I got no laughs. But I was happy that I had done it. I was happy that, okay, I've tried it, and now maybe I'll try it again. And like anything else, you just make a little progress here, and you slip back a little and continue to make progress. And I knew pretty soon that I was not cut out to be a stand-up comedian, the kind of guy that will take 250 gigs a year. He's on the road all the time. He goes to Las Vegas, then he goes to Jupiter, then he goes to Neptune, and then he goes to Buffalo. And just there are guys like that. And God bless them, because these are the guys that can do it. They have an iron constitution.
Jerry Seinfeld was that.
Jerry Seinfeld, absolutely. And many, many, I think there are fewer younger guys doing it now. At one time, I think it was more the domain of an earlier generation. I knew I didn't have that, so I felt like I'm just going to use this to kind of get into television.
And then you did Johnny.
Did the Johnny Carson show a couple of times, yeah.
And he instantly liked you.
Well, it went pretty well, it was no real surprise because I had about 4 or 5 years, and I had 20 minutes of material. 20 minutes of material, and I had it divided up roughly into 4 Tonight Show shots. And you've memorized it, every comma, every semicolon,
every
pause,
inflection.
Everything. So it's rote. So I knew the first one would go pretty well, and it did go pretty well. And to me, that was, and I think is still the biggest thrill I've had since I've been doing television.
That night?
That night, yeah.
What did he say to you when you sat down?
I have no idea. I can remember at the time I was sitting there, and this happened. I left Indianapolis in 75, and I think like 78, 3 years later, I'm sitting next to Johnny Carson. You know, it wasn't Rich Little. You know, Johnny was there that night. It wasn't Hugh Downs filling in for Johnny. It was Johnny. And I can remember, and this is forgive me if it's clumsily articulated, but my reaction to it was like, all your life you see a $5 bill. All your life you see a $5 bill. And then suddenly you see Lincoln. It's like, oh, my God, it's Honest Abe, the guy on the $5. And that was the reaction. You know, I was just completely wired for days and days and days after that. And still in all, that's was, I think, for me, the single most important, but also the single most thrilling experience of my life.
And how long was it before they asked you to come in and guest host?
It was, I think, was November of 78, and I think in March or April of 79, I did my first guest host there.
Yeah. And then you put together the morning show.
Put together the morning show, which was pitifully misguided.
Yeah, but the essence of what you do now was there, wasn't it?
The same thing, yeah. But I think in many ways, The show was to go live, I think, from 9 to 10:30. I think that's what it was, or 10 to 11:30.
Whatever,
I don't know. It was a live 90-minute show. Well, that's just suicide. And it's in the morning, we just wanted to do, we thought this might be our only opportunity at television, so boom, we just wanted to do everything. So we just did everything silly and stupid, and the first 6 weeks we didn't have a producer, and then we didn't have a director, and the host they had was me, so, you know, you're in a hole there. And it was just chaos. It was like a really bad television workshop at a community college. It was like, what do you want to do today, kids?
Yeah, but did somebody come and say, this is great, it's just on at the wrong time, and so we'll give you a lot of money just to go away and take care of yourself for a year until what to do?
I think somebody looked at it and giving us the benefit of the doubt, said, yes, it's on at the wrong time, prove to be that there is no proper time for me on television. But it was a giddy experience and also horrible. But we knew early on we were done. We just knew.
That's not going to work.
6 weeks into it, we knew we were on, and then we ended up being on 18 weeks. So once we knew we were gone, we were done, we just said, you know, it was bunker mentality. We don't care. We just, you know, we couldn't care less, and it was so much fun.
And when you went to do, finally, after that year, it was about a year off when they paid you a bunch of money and said, just come back later.
Right.
And you started 12:30, the Late Show.
Right.
What was the idea behind The Late Show? What was it? I mean, because what you saw late night was an attitude. You saw an irreverence. You saw a sense of having fun. You saw something that was not on television at the time.
Right. And I think it was dictated by, one, we knew we wanted to continue the essence of what we tried in the morning. And then also there were some logical constraints and definitions caused by the fact that we were coming after The Tonight Show. And what I really wanted to do was The Tonight Show. Even then, that's what I was comfortable with. I had hosted that show. I had watched that show. That's really what I wanted to do. But it doesn't make any sense. And Johnny wanted to make sure, you're not just going to be doing my show. So for those two modifying factors, we tried
Johnny
to make it
say,
different.
You do a different show. You can't do
that's
my
right.
show
because
hey,
right. sure.
we got one of mine, and that's enough.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm not pretending that ours would have been the same quality of his had it been.
Now, he owned it. Did he own it?
He did not own it. No, NBC owned it. He had, some protection money. A little, Johnny had a little taste. You want to open a candy store?
Yes.
A little help out here
kind
with
of
the,
a little
you know,
gatekeeper
with a little
there.
Something.
If you want to do that, you got to pass Johnny.
And I don't think it made him a wealthy man. Of course, he was, how long is a piece of string? But there was a little activity there. And I was always very deferential because I felt like, I knew they had to go to Johnny to say, is it okay if we put this kid in there? And he said yes. He could have said no, and who knows where I'd be now. But I still have a feeling I'd be talking to you somehow on a Friday night. Oh, God.
One way or the other, you would have gotten
in. Yeah, sir. These tag sales are great.
Yeah, I like
them,
too.
What'd you spend on this one?
But that show, and then you went through this whole process, and now in this book, Late Shift, and this movie on HBO, and you've talked about that enough. When you were thinking about going to 11:30 and all of that, do you have any regrets now that you went to CBS rather than NBC?
No. I tell you, looking back on it and trying to remember the events and the feelings and the circumstances of the day, I knew Johnny was leaving. We all knew Johnny was leaving, if not when exactly. Generally, we knew, unlikely that Johnny would be there celebrating his 100th birthday, although he probably could have. So I did what I felt comfortable doing by way of making it known that I would like to be considered for that show, just to be considered. I never went to anybody and said, give me the damn show. I was approached in those days by Johnny's attorney, Henry Bushkin.
Yeah, Bushkin.
And Henry had some plan, and also the strangest looking hairpiece I'd ever laid eyes on.
I think they parted company, didn't they?
Henry and his hairpiece?
No,
I would
Henry
hope.
And Johnny.
Yeah, they did. They had some kind of plan that smelled to me like a palace coup. And I can remember going to breakfast with these guys and thinking, I'll stay on the bus while you hop the fence. It just didn't make any sense to me, but they were gonna place me in Johnny's chair, and I can remember saying to them, you've had this chat with Johnny, right? Not yet. And that's when I just thought, well, no, that's okay. I'll get my merit badge some other way.
But could you pick up the phone and call Johnny and say,
I called Peter LaSalle, and I said, I've just had this very peculiar meeting, and I said, I'm not altogether comfortable with it. And I was not altogether comfortable with the notion. Johnny Carson gave me a career. I was not altogether comfortable, not altogether, completely not comfortable with the notion of, oh, by the way, Johnny, you know when you're ready to fly? Okay, I'll just, you don't mind if I have the boys come in and measure your office? I couldn't do that. Yeah. I'm not that kind of person, and he had been so generous and genuine to me. So this was where I found myself in all of the, strategy and the posturing and jockeying for that position.
If Ovitz had come into your life earlier, mm-hmm. say, a few years before Johnny decided to hang it up,
right.
Do you think you would have ended up at NBC?
Yes, and I know that for a fact because Michael told me so. Whenever we'd have these meetings, he said, look, if I had been handling this, you'd be there now. Said,
you'd be Mr. NBC.
All right, okay, Michael. And I believe he's probably right because in those days, I was concerned with two things, doing our show and not upsetting Johnny. I just felt like I'm here, they know I'm here, and I've told them I would like to be considered for the job. Beyond that, I wasn't going to do anything because I just didn't want, I was so uncomfortable with the notion that I would be the one that was trying to leverage Johnny out of that chair.
And so in awe of him.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
But Ovitz could have made the deal for you because he would have introduced you to some sense of a way to make the play.
Yes. Yes, I believe so. Absolutely. On the other hand, it never occurred to me that I needed Michael Ovitz in my life because I just thought, as with any other job I've been lucky enough to get in my life, if you're good enough, they'll give you the job. And, you know, they can make that choice.
There was an implicit sense when you were doing the 12:30 show, I'm doing well, it's attracting a lot of attention. The implicit bargain here is when Johnny steps down, I moved
right.
in.
Right, yeah. It was also discussed contractually. And Brandon Tartikoff and I had kind of a casual discussion toward that end. So it was in the air. We knew of it. NBC knew of it. I certainly knew of it. But I just always felt like it will come down to, you know, okay, we want you for the job, or no, we don't want you for the job. The notion that you could politic for that job, especially a job of that consequence, was radical to me.
When you made the decision to go to CBS, what went through your mind in terms of what you would have to do at 11:30 that would be different than what you were doing at 12:30?
Well, at the time, that was a big, big issue because, and I don't know why, but people view 12:30 and 11:30 as being two completely different, almost polarized spots on the clock, and they're not really. The people that are watching at 12:30 are people that have been up at 11:30 and continue to watch. And the people that watch at 11:30, and it's not that different, you know, it's the same deal. But we imposed on ourselves kind of a strict scrutiny, and we decided, okay, it's got to look like more money. I remember talking to Hal Gurney, make the opening, make New York City look like a postcard. Make everybody yeah. salivate when they see New York City. And as you know, many of the citizens here, that's all they do is salivate.
Yes.
Make it look like Las Vegas. Make people want to get on the first damn bus and come to New York. And I think that was the first kind of thing we discussed. And then the rest of it was minor, you know, like we added some guys to the band. We looked at the wardrobe. We had a bigger theater. And beyond that, it wasn't much different.
What makes a good show?
For me, my personal criteria, as we were discussing earlier, we have an audience of about 500 yeah. people. They come from wherever they come from. They write in for tickets 6 months, 3 months, a year in advance. They get plane tickets, they get babysitters, they get rental cars, they go to hotels, they have to park their car, they have to walk, they have to wait in line. So we get these people in there. And if the end of the evening, I get the sense that these people are disappointed, I realize I've failed. And what makes a good show for me is any single element or any combination of elements by design or accident that pleases these people and makes them satisfied with the difficulty they've had to endure to get there. I feel like, great, that's it, stop the clock, no more calls, this show will be fine. Because I think that sense of enjoyment, you know, breaks through the glass.
But do you think you're the best judge of that?
Yes.
Do you really?
Yes.
Because I know people have said to me, they come to you and say, great show.
Well, they're
and
little suck-up weasels. You know, yeah, I mean, I saw, you got a lobby full of them here yourself,
weasels.
Golly, for heaven's
yeah,
sake.
Everybody needs them, don't
yeah,
they?
Yeah, of course.
But you're convinced you know what's a good show.
Yes. Yes. I do know because I'm sitting right there. I feel yeah. it. You
and
know,
how many times a week do you have a good show on the average?
Not as many as we would like. I think this
three out of five?
Three out of five would be great. Man, I'm telling you, I'd sell my soul for 3 out of 5. And sometimes we get there. Sometimes we get 5 out of 5. Some nights, it's, you know, you get a good show, 1 out of 5, and you think, ooh, okay.
How different is the show you're doing and the show that Carson did for all those years?
Well, you know, we're doing circus time. You know, we got people swinging on things. We're setting fire to stuff. We got folks running around naked. And Johnny come out to his monologue, the favorite part of everyone's evening. And then maybe he'd do Aunt Blabby, and that would be it. And maybe he'd do Aunt Blabby once a month. Maybe he'd do Karnak. Maybe he'd do Stump the Band, and that was it. And then he'd sit down, and Florence Henderson would come out, and, you know, Johnny would, you know, say silly things to Florence Henderson. So, I mean, I don't mean to suggest that he was loafing. He was doing a lot of work, but it was not this this barrage of stuff where, okay, let's see what Party Boy's doing tonight. Come on, let's go, do something, light something up, scare somebody.
But my point is, that do you think you've got to do that because that's where the audience is in 1996, or do you think it is simply a reflection of your sense of humor, of your comedy?
I wish I could say it was a reflection of my sense of humor and my comedy. Mostly at the core, I think it is. I don't know whether we have to do that to attract and keep an audience. I just don't know.
Then why do you do it?
Because of the competitive nature of the current marketplace of television, which is now seems like infinite. You feel that that's required. And Lord knows, I don't know if it is required. But that's the feeling. That's the sense. It's got to be lively.
The feeling of you or the feeling of your staff?
Everybody. And I think we have contributed to this, sadly. I think we've bit on our own bait here. Because when we first came on the air, I mean, every night we had, you know, hot air balloons going up in the audience. We had people jumping out of blimps. We had you know, it was just nuts. But we thought, you know, this is our one chance. We got to load it up and go here. And I think that... then the Tonight Show, from that experience, I think they also decided, well, look what these guys are doing. We, you know, we
got to do that plus.
Yeah.
It reminds me a little bit of like what happened in daytime television, though. I mean, you know, Donahue started doing
right,
this, and then
right,
everybody
right.
took it a little further.
That's right.
Until it collapsed.
I think it's the same dynamic.
Its own way.
And I wish I could tell you I was confident that that's the right way to do it. And I don't know. I watch every Friday night, I get a chance to watch Tom Snyder, who's on Just After Us. And when I see Tom, and when I see shows like this, and some other shows, I'm reminded, you know, that maybe what you really need here, maybe all you really need, is legitimate communication between two people chatting and people watching. And I don't know.
But you don't trust that for...
No, I don't. I don't. Because, you know, I've read too many things about our show. You know, it goes, it's dull. It's old, it's tired, and you think, well, yeah, that's me. I'm here, yes, present, I'm dull, I'm old, I'm tired. Tonight at 11:30.
But what do all those writers do on your, you've got 15 writers?
I guess, I don't know, good
do
heaven.
Do you know them, and what is
also,
it they
I've
do?
I've met most of them. I think at the Christmas party, a lot of them come up and introduce themselves.
Hi, Dave.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I've seen you stealing supplies. Yeah, nice
what
to have
is
here.
It they do? Do they write the skits? Do they write the monologue? Do they write what?
Well, yes.
All of that.
In answer to your question.
Then what do you do?
I actually do very little.
Is that true?
And it's just as well.
Yeah. No, come on. You come in there. This show is your life.
Yes.
As this is for me.
Right.
I mean, it is, there's nothing you'd rather do.
That's right.
And you are driven, obsessed to make it as good as you think it
That's
can
right.
be.
That's right. And my influence on this production is, as it has been for a long, long time now, the ultimate yes or no. And when you have really good people, you're going to get more yeses than nos. So that's my only contribution to this, is, you know, hopefully saying yes more often than I say no.
What do you enjoy the most about it? Is it the monologue? Is it the skit? Is it the interview?
It's, for me, if something goes crazy... And one of two things can happen. If something breaks down, is not planned, something untoward occurs, it can go one of two ways. It can go up or it can go down. And when something happens, something tiny, something from the audience, something from Paul, something from a guest, something just a speck on somebody's coat, and when that turns into something huge, and then it will, that little tiny thing, dominate the rest of the show. For me, that's the best. That's like cold fusion. It's like, come in here. What's the guy's Alexander Bell? What's it? Come in here. I've, you know, it's that kind of thing. What's the guy's name?
Fermi? I don't know. The guy who discovered
Fermi. No, the guy who invented the atomic telephone.
Albert Einstein.
No. Alexander Graham Bell.
Exactly.
Said, Watson, come in here. Right, yes, right, that, you feel like, yes. Look what we've created.
The monologue. Is it important to you?
It's not important to me.
Like it is to Jay, say.
I think it's certainly significant because it's the beginning of the show. And you want to do the best you can right at the beginning of the show. When we did the 12:30 show, Johnny said, you know, don't do a monologue. So we never had to worry about it.
Why did he say that?
He just, again, he didn't want the shows to be similar.
Right.
There's nothing better than a great joke. Nothing better than a great joke. Nothing harder to write than a great joke. So I have a great deal of respect for that skill. And I wish I could say that it's, you can write 20 great jokes 5 nights a week. I don't think it can be done. So you end up writing things that you think need to be addressed. You end up writing things that have kind of a knee-jerk reaction. I mean, for months, the punchline to every joke we told was Joey Buttafuoco. Kaboom!
You knew.
Yeah. So it becomes a bit of a manipulation, and it's never been my favorite pursuit in comedy. But I recognize it's valuable, and like I say, there's nothing better than a great joke.
When you hit at CBS, and everybody said, this is as good as it's going to be, did you enjoy it? Did you enjoy it when you were on top, when Tom Shales was saying you were the greatest thing ever in the history of broadcasting? You love that?
No. I must say it was enjoyable.
Yeah.
But I did not, it wasn't like a blood transfusion.
No.
It didn't bring me false pride or, it was nice. It was nice, but for me, and I said this when we left NBC, the best part about this is we just continue to do the work.
You do it.
And that was always the best part and still is the best part. But all of that other stuff, you know, I'm not a kid. I know when that inflates, you know, the same valve that inflated that can also deflate that.
When you went from 1 to 2, could you see it coming?
Yes. Yes, clearly. It was about a year and a half ago in September, and There were things that happened to the network that concerned me. I didn't know exactly what they meant, but they concerned me. And then by the beginning of the fall season, a year and a half ago, we could pretty well see which way the wind was blowing. I did not in those days think that it was going to be this long, certainly, and I didn't think it was going to be this deep. But we could see it coming.
And do you believe you'll be number one again?
I think it's difficult to say.
Because of the prime time schedule at CBS, because of how local news does at CBS, because of the affiliate lineup,
there's
all the things you have no control of.
A lot of things we don't have any control of, and I don't want to make it sound like that's all responsible for our current situation, because, you know, we have our ups and downs as well. I would say that if we were a network again, the way CBS had been a network for, you know, dozens of years, sure, we got a shot at being number one. There are now other obstacles that make me think if it's going to happen, it's going to take a little longer than we would like it to happen.
Like what?
Some of the things that you mentioned. You know, I think that losing NFL football was tough.
CBS and NFL football go together like 60 minutes
at
CBS.
It's a great loss leader, you know. We had the Olympics a couple of years ago. That was great. I think we have one more Olympics coming up, and then they go over to NBC for eternity.
Do you feel a little bit less protected because Ovitz is now at Disney, although I assume you still talk to him every day or so?
Talked to Michael today, as a matter of fact.
What did Michael say?
It was hard to hear because he was in one of those goofy costumes greeting people getting off a bus.
Yes. So saying, come on in.
Everything was a little
muffled. Michael Eisner. Yeah. We love Michael. But you talk to him a lot. I mean,
yes.
He still is a powerful influence in your...
He's a nice man. I've enjoyed my association. I'm endlessly entertained by this guy. Endlessly entertained by this guy. You know, because this is the guy. You know, this is...
He's the guy. As you said last night, a couple nights. He's the man.
He's the dice roller, you know. He's the boy with the cufflinks, and I just get a huge kick out of him.
Yeah.
And he put me back in business, and everything that he told me would happen came to pass. And as long as I've been alive, as long as anybody's been alive, how often does that happen, you know? So I have a lot of regard for him, and I enjoy him now. He comes up to the office every now and I like to make fun of him.
And bring out the caviar.
I like to push him around a little bit.
But he made you a believer that whatever you wanted, he could help you get.
Well, you know what it was? I had been with talent agencies. I had been with 2 or 3 talent agencies. And you go into a talent agent and you think, man, here I am, I'll be at the house, you just call me. You know, yeah. Cut to several years later, yes. Is the phone out of order? Hello.
Where are they?
But Ovitz comes in and he says, we're going to do this. And the next thing you know, all of those things came to pass.
Did you walk out of the room when you first met him and said to Peter, the Godfather, I have met the Godfather?
Well, I've been told that I said that, and perhaps I did say that.
Because that's in Carter's book.
If I did say that, it was in a jocular tone. But he... You know, he seemed like he knew what he was talking about, and in show business, nobody knows what they're talking about.
Goldman was right? Nobody out here knows anything. What did Goldman that said that? Who was it said, nobody out here knows anything, talking about Hollywood and show business?
Well, that's what I always thought about. Everybody said, oh, he's a genius. Michael's a genius. Well, I've spent time with the guy, and I'm here to tell you, he's not a genius.
But he knows what he's talking about.
He's just this much smarter than everybody else.
The Oscars. Did you want to do it again?
Only from the standpoint that I thought it would really be fun. I thought it would be, this time, we could really hurt some people. But it was not a burning desire, and this is how dumb I am. It wasn't until like weeks later, people were saying, how do you feel about being snubbed? And then I thought, oh, you know, I mean, if you don't know,
nobody
you've been
told
snubbed,
me I've been
yeah.
Snubbed.
So then it took on a whole different perspective. Yeah. I still feel like one day I'll do it again, but this would have been a good thing to do. And, I understand why they didn't do it, but man, it would have been entertaining this year.
Now, Quincy made the call, I guess, did he?
I guess.
Okay, but why couldn't, if you'd wanted it, Michael could have picked up the phone, probably, and made it happen.
Yes? Probably so, yeah, probably so.
So did you think about that? Did you ask him to make it happen?
Nope.
You didn't?
I'm not that kind of person. I just
really
kind of sit back and see which way things go. But this time, had I hosted that show, it really would have been like a drunk trying to disarm a bomb. I'm telling you, every set in the world, oh my, well, he's got the pliers. Oh, he cut the wrong wire. And, you know, I mean, it had a lot of great elements built in because of last year. You know, I just think everybody would have rolled, okay, let's see what happens this year.
See if he makes the same mistake. Yeah. The idea was that when you did it last year, you did your show, and you didn't do the Oscars, and that was the mistake. Do you accept that, or do you look back and say...
Oh, I think the only mistake was probably my performance. You know, I probably was more nervous than I thought I was going to be, and probably not as confident. I was out of my element. But the second time I do stuff, I usually get it. First time, a little bit goofy. But I can't blame it on anybody else. The people that we worked with just, you know, let us do anything we wanted, and, you know, we lived or died by it. And if you hated it, you know, sorry, get over it. You know, figure out a way to live with that. But it's, to me, I guess it's supposed to be some kind of deep scar, but it, you know, after the initial, the initial heat, you know, cloud that I just thought, well, yeah, I screwed it up. So what? It's the Academy Awards, for God's sake. I'm happy I screwed it
just
up.
Just a billion people.
I'm
who the hell cares about a billion people?
Well, first of all, that figure is not true. You think about it. How many people are there in this world? 6 billion? Is that 5 billion? That ain't happening. No, that ain't.
See,
no, that's
it.
A billion people. Well, I don't think so.
Well, oh, come on. I mean, at least a half a billion from China watching this. They're setting their schedule now.
Letterman screw up again.
When you begin to look at the show now, are you happy? I mean, in a sense, you're number two. Is it different adjusting to being number two at all for you now?
It doesn't feel any different because we think, you know, it's the same amount of effort going into the show now as it was in the beginning. And on any given night, you feel, you know, like you're on the moon. You just feel, it fills you with that sense of... This is the greatest thing on television. And then on any other given night, you feel like, well, I'll just be going now. Could somebody bring me my car, if you don't mind?
Yeah, but if it doesn't work, the story is you go up to the room and you watch it because you want to see why it didn't work.
Exactly. I want to see what happened. I want to see what I could have done. I want to see the mistake I made and hopefully learn from it and then go on. I don't watch the show at home. If I feel things go well, I don't watch it at all.
How much better are you now in February 1996 than you were in September 1993 when you started this, or 94?
Well, not enough. You know, I wish I was much, much better. And I'm telling you, some nights it just feels like, have I done this before? Because the variables in doing a show like this aren't infinite. You know what they are. It's a half a dozen things. And on any given night, one of these half a dozen variables can just bite you in the ass, and you think, oh, yeah, this, I've been through this a million times. Why didn't I see it coming, you know?
You enjoy the interviews?
Some of them I do. Some of them I actually do. If there's some kind of legitimate interchange, some kind of legitimate exchange, yeah, sometimes I really do. I get a kick out of them. If somebody says or does something that genuinely makes me laugh, I just think, this is great. You know, I get paid a lot of money and somebody's actually entertaining me. So when, you know, that's fun.
Somebody said to me today, we're talking about what you do and what I do, the very different spectrum. They said, when somebody comes on the on David's show, they're expected to perform.
That's right.
And when someone comes on your show, what you want to do is for them not to perform,
so you
can find out who they are.
Probably so. And maybe that actually works against us a bit, because we found that people in show business, hugely successful people, some of them don't get that this is an opportunity for them to demonstrate why people should spend money on their movies, why people should buy their records, why people should watch them on television. Some of these people seem to be oblivious to that.
Yeah.
So, some nights, I want to get out the sphygmomanometer and see, let's see if there's a pulse. Let's see if there's blood in the veins, because I can't begin to tell you the number of times somebody has just taken the opportunity to come out and have about a 12-minute nap on the air. And I just think, well, no, wait a minute. Are we both in show business here? Well, we do, and sometimes I get a little ragged with them, and then people say, oh, he's mean, he's being mean again. But then you have people like Bill Murray, like Steve Martin, yeah. like Tom Hanks, like Bruce Willis, Demi Moore. There's about a dozen of these people, top stars, who really get it. And
they understand what was expected
sure.
of them.
And Tom Hanks comes on like a first-time comedian, and he works on it and works on it and works on it. We have a piece on the primetime show that we did with Steve Martin. He had a play in production and a play opening the week he was with us. He came in 3 days in a row to pre-tape this for us and came in the morning of his appearance to work on this piece. And he's always been like that. And Bill Murray has always been like that. And Bruce Willis has always been like that. I just wish, you know, everybody, and even when I used to be on The Tonight Show, I would spend, you know, 6-8 weeks making sure, because what you wanted to do was make Johnny laugh. You didn't want to come out there and just sort of, you know, all of a sudden Johnny's talking to Ed. You don't want that happening.
What are you going to change now? Staff a little bit? You bring back, Rob is coming back, is he? Because
yeah,
he's
Rob,
been off
Rob
working
is
with
back.
Bonnie
he's
Hunt.
Got a, he's working on another project. The staff, I guess if you looked at it over the years, have been pretty consistent, but still a bit of flux. Our director, Hal Gurney, who was with us from the beginning, retired. So that was a change for us. We're constantly, you know, we're bringing in a new set. But, you know, ultimately, all that's a load of crap. It comes down to, you know, how well am I doing the job and how well do people respond to me? That's the essential here. So, you know, it doesn't make any difference. You know, superficial changes are a little... The only thing a superficial change will do you, it'll get in the newspaper and people say, oh, did you hear that? Dave's got a new curtain. You want to... He's a new curtain? Do you want to stay up? You know, and that's beyond that. It's not much you can do.
Has anything changed since you Westinghouse took over?
Let's see. We got a guy now who passes out paper towels. We used to be able to just get them by the handful. They got a guy now who will kind of count them out for you. You know, like he's rationing paper towels. That's the biggest change.
Has Michael Jordan called you?
No. No, he's not called me. He's afraid of me. He has not called me. It's one of the
now,
great...
Are you serious about this, or is this just something to have
serious.
Fun with?
No,
I mean,
completely serious. No. History will reflect on this as one of the great oversights and snubs of modern broadcasting.
You don't care if he calls you or not.
I don't... No. Here's what had happened. In the beginning, Westinghouse.
The benefit of anybody who doesn't know, this is the guy who runs Westinghouse, and Westinghouse now owns CBS.
Yeah, and he came from a company in Dallas, Frito-Lay Pepsi. So whenever there was trouble, it was always, send him a case of Diet Pepsi.
Yeah.
That was it. That's what this guy knows. That's the extent of this guy's management skills. Jalapeno dip, send him a... So they buy the company at some kind of, I don't know what they paid for it, not much. And now they...
$5 billion.
$5 billion. The ABC deal was what, $21 billion, something like that?
19.
Yeah. So, you know, they're bottom feeders. That's what we know about them. This is what it is. It's attention Kmart shoppers.
And how much money does your show generate for them?
Huge, huge money. We're the single biggest money-making concern on the network. So now, Mr. Big Shot Michael Jordan decides he's coming to town, and you're going to survey the plantation, see what he's bought, you know, get a look at the hands. And he goes over to 60 Minutes. 60 Minutes, that's where he goes first.
Big money maker for them.
Yeah, but not as much money as we're throwing off.
Right.
So he goes over to see them. And as I've said 100 times, and it's like 2 blocks away from where we work. He goes to see the boys at 60 Minutes because he's hoping if he kisses up to these guys, the next time Westinghouse has a toxic dump spill, you know, they'll look the other way. So he kisses up to those boys, who's back on his plane, and the next thing you know, boom. Well, we were sitting there, we cleaned up the place, maybe he's coming, maybe the boss, never came. Oh, he'll call, never call. We'll get a card at Christmas, no card at Christmas. So then I realized, well, this guy, we got to straighten this guy out. We got to straighten this punk out.
You
this guy's looking through the wrong end of the telescope.
You take a couple of shots at him and he'll respond.
Yeah.
And has he responded?
No, because he's a coward. I challenged the guy. I said, come on, let's go big time. You and me, we'll fight right here. And I can't fight anybody.
Invite him on the show.
We've invited him on the show.
To come on the show.
Invited him on the show to come on to it and fight. I thought, well, you know, fight. But as I now find out, the reason he won't be on the show is because we tape at 5:30 to 6:30, and that's happy hour. He's not going to miss that.
Why give that up for appearance on television?
No, no.
I sent him
network.
A case of Diet Slice. But
deep inside of you, this ticks you off.
The truth of it is I just couldn't care less.
I don't care what Michael Jordan ever calls you.
I couldn't care less.
You don't even want to meet him.
I want to tell you something, Charlie. In my lifetime, I've met plenty of executives. I couldn't care less.
Well, I mean, someone today who's an executive said, what is it with David and television executives? Does he have nothing but contempt for them?
It's a device, it's a mechanism, and it's as old as the medium
sure,
itself.
Suits can always take it.
Sure. Yeah. And like I used to say at General Electric, there's not a damn thing we're going to do that is going to damage this corporate global monster. It's like, what, you know, I'm shooting my mouth up at 12:30. The same is true with Westinghouse and this guy. And the only thing I enjoyed about it is being able to, in front of a vast television audience, challenge the guy to a fight. I just thought, well, that's silly. You can't do that. But the truth of it is, do I care? Absolutely not. Could not care less.
Do you enjoy New York? Do you go out? What's your lifestyle like?
New York to me is the only real city in North America. There's some beautiful, beautiful places.
How about Chicago? Indianapolis?
Indianapolis is a great town. Yeah. It's a great town, and I love it, and I think the world of it. And every time I go back there, I'm just filled with all kind of melancholia and enjoyment and nostalgia. The people there are nice. The food is like 50% cheaper and 20% better in Indianapolis. The springtime in the Midwest is otherworldly. It's unbelievable.
Okay, but here is this wonderful city. Do you go to museums? Do you go out to dinner? I mean, their idea is out there a little bit that Dave stays home. He goes to Connecticut to his place, or he goes to wherever.
Yeah. I do. I go home. Don't people go home?
Well, they do. But, I mean, are you enjoying this place? Do you go to museums? Do you go to the garden to watch the Pacers play when they come in?
Not currently. I've done all of those things. I've been to every museum. Not every museum. Most of the museums. I've been to plays. I haven't been to the last play I saw was Glengarry Glen Ross. I have problems at plays because of the seating in these theaters. I'm an enormous man. And if I have to sit there jammed into these super coach seats they have in every theater, you know, halfway through the first act, my knees have locked and are numb, and I have to have a guy with a forklift come and get my ass out. And I do love being here, and I recognize all of the cultural advantages and privileges that you have with this city.
Yeah.
And I take them as I can avail myself.
Do you really? I mean, do you go out much at all?
The schedule I'm on now is... one thing we would like to do is invoke some humanity into our schedule. It does not exist. It does not exist.
Like what? What time do you come into the office?
Well, my day begins. I get up at dawn every day, and then I leave the house.
Come on, do you get up at dawn?
Get up at dawn and run to Bridgeport. I go right up I-95, and that's about a 60-mile round-trip run. I come back, I have the breakfast, I have the pancakes, I have the eggs, I have the rasher of bacon, I have the toast medley, I have the jams, the jellies.
Of course you do.
And then I shower off and drive to work. I try to get to work around 10, and then from 10 o'clock on, it's a fist fight. And we get
done. So what do you do all day?
Yes and no. Yes and no.
Just, yes, I'll
okay,
do this, just, no,
yes,
I won't.
No, yeah, pretty much that's
Someone said to me that just for the top 10 list, you've got 15 rides, and each of them make up a top 10 list when you decide what the subject's going to be, and then you select the top 10.
Right.
Yes, yes,
right.
Yes, yes, no,
right.
No, no,
that's
no.
Right.
Yes,
that's
yes,
right.
Yes. That's right. I mean, the top 10 then ought to be brilliant every night.
Well, it certainly is not. But sometimes Geez, I'd just give you $1,000 if I could light this cigar, Charlie. Look at this. It's look like Smokey the Bear is coming in to show us how to build a campfire.
Well, I remember when Sean Penn was here.
Yeah, but sometimes, unfortunately, you know, like television, you're always late. You're always late in television. I by the time I get to work, you know, I'm an hour late, and that's just the way it goes. And sometimes things that every day is the best compromise we can make. And sometimes the thing chips fall your way, sometimes they don't. But the plane's taken off at 5:30 one way or the other.
Celebrity doesn't mean a damn to you. And in fact, it's a distraction.
The first thing that kind of got my attention years and years ago, when I was first on The Tonight Show, I recognized almost immediately that people, strangers in all walks of life that I would come in contact with, were friendlier to me. Friendly, nice, considerate, and behaved kind of the way you think people behave to people. But it was a dramatic change, and it was literally overnight. And it has been that way ever since. That part of it, I just think, is wonderful. Because instead of being part of just a faceless group of people struggling with and against one another, it invokes, again, some humanity. People are nice to me, I'm nice to them. Sadly, I don't think real life is like that. And this is, to me, the great benefit and luxury of being well-known. So I enjoy it. I try not to abuse it. And I do my best to be nice to people who are always nice to me. And I count myself really being lucky for that. Because I can remember, and I think everybody who is not fortunate enough to be well-known understands what this struggle is. You know, people, for no good reason, sometimes just go out of their way to make your life unpleasant. But that all changed about 20 years ago, and I just think, man, if this was really the world, that would just be keen.
We're always celebrities.
Everybody happy, everybody nice to see you. Oh, nice to see you. And it's contagious. When they're nice to you, you're just nice back to them.
One of the great things, in addition to that, about being a broadcaster is you get to see your work product every night.
Right.
I mean, think of the people who work every day. They don't get a chance to see. I mean, you build every day to 5:30.
Right.
I build every day to 6
right.
o'clock. I tape them 30 minutes later than you do. And you get to see that night what you have crafted that
right. But
that
there are
day.
You know, there are many other pursuits in the world that are like that. I always kind of liken our operation to a small restaurant. You know, you come in, you go to the market, you see what's available, you see what's fresh, you put it together, you get a menu, and then you can see if people like it. And then, you know, the next day you look through the cash receipts and you know how you did. So it's not unique, but it is satisfying, very satisfying.
They also say about you that you're enormously self-critical, that when things don't go right, you don't blame anybody but Dave.
Well, that's being generous. You know, sometimes
impossible to live with, but...
Ultimately, I accept the responsibility for everything that goes wrong. And it's like a guy driving a race car. You know, they build the car, they put the engine in it, they tune it, they fine-tune it, they adjust the aerodynamics, they adjust the fuel flow, whatever, and then I go out there and put it in the wall. I mean, every day I'm given the elements of a great car. And some days, because I'm human, I just stack it up. And there's nothing more discouraging than
stack it up against a wall.
Exactly. And knowing that the staff of 50 or 60 people have done their best every day, then they put me in the damn car, and oh my gosh, he's tapped the wall in turn four. So I feel like I'm I'm responsible, and I should be responsible. My name's in the credits. I get the big paycheck. You know, it's me. I can take it, and I screw it up more than anybody else in the production.
Tell me, I've got a thing here about this special. What's going to happen on Monday night, February 19th? You've got, listen to this, folks, Howard Stern, Robin Williams, Mary Tyler Moore. Your mom will be there.
Mom will be there.
10 to 11 p.m. on CBS. Who else is on this? Isabella Rossellini.
Rosie Perez.
Elizabeth Berkey. Steve Martin.
Yeah.
Baywatch's Yasmin Bleeth.
Yasmin Bleeth.
Victoria. Victoria's Secret's Frederick.
Yeah, did meet her.
Oh, how about Sports Illustrated's Tyra Banks?
Yeah, I believe she was
and
there.
And Linda
as well.
Evangelista.
Mm-hmm.
Lauren Hutton.
Mm-hmm.
Cameo roles by Regis. Regis going to be there.
I guess. You know, the thing of it is, we can't hardly keep Regis out. You know, when we first went on the air, it was cute because every night there'd be Regis. And we thought, oh, that's nice. He's just being neighborly.
Yeah.
And then, you know, 2.5 years later, every night there's Regis. We're all sick of it.
But we love him because he's a hell of a broadcaster.
I think Regis is great. I think
Regis
has something. I think Howard Stern has something. These guys know what it is. And I don't know if they even know what it is, but they just have it. And they use it, and it make it... I mean, it's something very compelling. Regis is talking right to you. Doesn't make any difference what Howard Stern is talking about, you know, lesbians wrestling or whatever the hell is breaking loose in Howard's studio. Something very compelling. Undeniably, you have to listen to Howard, and that's a great gift. And I know Howard would whine about the comparison to he and Regis, but I think there's a kindred spirit there, but perhaps at opposite ends of the scale.
How about Imus?
I think Don Imus is very good. I have a lot of respect for this guy because what I know of him, he kind of rebuilt for himself a career and a persona after years and years of substance abuse and being in radio a long, long time. And nobody really survives in radio or television a long, long time unless they're first rate. And I think his present incarnation, I think, is endlessly entertaining, and I have a lot of respect for him as well.
And so do I for you. Thank you for doing this.
Charlie, thank you very much.
Pleasure.
Nice to see you, sir.
David Letterman, an hour, Monday night, February 19th, 10 o'clock, the late night special on CBS. Thank you for joining us on this Friday. We'll see you Monday.
By a grant from USA Networks as part of our continuing commitment to innovative television. Through USA Network and the Sci-Fi Channel, we provide original entertainment to America and the world. Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders. To order Charlie Rose program transcripts for $5 each and video cassettes for $29.95 each, call 1-800 All News, or write to Journal Graphics at the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.